This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
So I'm going to talk about antibiotic use and sort of coexistence with the microbial world, and hopefully kind of get you thinking about the relationship that we have with bacteria. I have no potential conflicts of interest to disclose. An overview of our session, and I'll start out by talking a little bit about the world that's on and in us that we don't see, the world of bacteria and other microorganisms. And then we'll talk about the potential benefits that actually come from this world that's on and in us, but then also about what goes wrong. So what disturbs this balance? We'll talk about, and we'll give a little antibiotics 101. It won't be a very in-depth discussion of antibiotics, but if people are interested in sort of learning more about the different antibiotics, how they're used, et cetera, I'd be happy to provide you with some of that information. And we'll talk a little bit about what hopefully will make a little bit more sense later, but the tragedy of the common broad-spectrum antibiotic. As many of you know, antibiotic resistance is an important public health issue, and this is on both the bacteria and ourselves. It's an issue of our relationship with bacteria. It's also a relationship with how we practice the medical arts and how we feel about uncertainty in treating patients. We'll talk about things we can try and do to preserve the miracle that is antibiotics, and then talk about some sort of new frontiers in bacterial-human relations that sort of are a little bit of a new paradigm from this current paradigm, which is, like I said, this sort of war on bugs. Those of you, if you've made it this far in the series about infectious diseases, you're probably not a germaphobe. But if you happen to be, you might want to cover your ears for just a couple of minutes as we talk about this world that's on and in us. So every surface of you that touches the outside environment, your skin, as you heard about in your previous lecture, but as well as a lot of internal surfaces of you, so your upper respiratory tract, your gastrointestinal tract, your genitourinary tract, are covered in bacteria and sometimes fungi all the time. Okay? And it's interesting, there are actually little different communities of bacteria in different places. So you can see that, I know this is kind of fuzzy, but the organisms that live in your stomach are different than the organisms that live in your skin, are different than the organisms that live in your small intestine. So there really is a whole sort of world down there with different communities living in different places. And these are all on you. So you're surrounded. And not only that, you are outnumbered. So there are 10 to the 13th, or about 10 trillion human cells that make you up. There are 10 to the 14th, so tenfold more bacterial cells that are on or in your body. So obviously our cells are bigger. That's why you don't see as many of these bacterial cells. But there are more of them than there are of you. So really, it makes more sense to sort of think about us as bacteria-human hybrids than really just bacteria, or excuse me, than humans with some bacteria along for the ride. If this really freaks you out, and you say, well, I would like to not be this person, and maybe I'll go out and take a bunch of antibiotics, you should know that that won't work. They are not going away. If you were to go out and take the broadest spectrum antibiotic cocktail that you can find, believe me, we have some people in the medical center on such cocktails right now, you would not permanently eradicate the bacteria that live on and in you. Furthermore, for some organisms, such as viruses, actually essentially become a part of you. So everybody in here, pretty much, has had chickenpox, like this unfortunate little kid. Chickenpox is a virus, and when that virus infects you, it actually makes its way into your nerve cells and stays with you for the rest of your life. And most of us, this will be the only manifestation we'll ever have, but some of us, you know, over the course of our lives, will have another manifestation. Did we know what that manifestation is? Okay, so people are very well educated on the subject, but yes, shingles or herpes zoster is just another manifestation. So again, depending on what organisms we're talking about, either there are bacteria that you could temporarily eradicate, they will come back. There are viruses that can enter your cells and basically never leave. And in fact, some viruses are to the point where they actually integrate into your DNA. So there's no getting out of this relationship that we have with microorganisms, no matter how much we'd like to try. But it's okay. We were designed this way. We evolved this way. This sort of maybe looks like the London Tube map. But what this is showing is sort of the co-evolution of primates and the bacteria that live in and on them. So here are a lineage of bacteria, and you can see where the bacteria split off from each other. And then this is where the different primates start evolving from each other. And you can see that when humans and bonobos split, then certain bacteria went with us and certain bacteria went with them. When we split from chimps, we got certain bacteria, and some went this way. And so really, over the course of time, we've co-evolved with these organisms. So that's, you know, should be reassuring to you. This is sort of the way that it is supposed to be. And there are benefits to this. So we'll talk briefly about some of them. There are many more that we could potentially discuss, but in order to get to the antibiotic section of these, I'm just going to highlight a few examples. So these are mice. These are special mice, actually. We talked about that none of us can completely eradicate all of the organisms that we have on and in us, but it turns out with special techniques, such as being born in a certain way and living in certain sterile environments, we can develop mice that have no bacteria. Okay, they're essentially born to mothers that don't have any bacteria. They live in sterile environments. So we can see what the effect is of not having bacteria in at least this mouse model. And it turns out that one of the roles of bacteria in your gut is to metabolize some of these things that we don't metabolize so well. So gut bacteria can metabolize carbohydrates and lipids in some ways more efficiently than we can, and these byproducts can be available to the host. So in experiments with these germ-free mice, that mice raised in this environment actually required more food to get to the same weight as mice that were raised in a normal environment. So these germ-free mice had to eat more in order to get the same level of nutrition, because they weren't having the bacteria provide some of that nutrition for them. As well, bacteria have a role in synthesizing and supplying essential vitamins, so B and K vitamins particularly, and germ-free mice eating sterilized food that doesn't bring any bacteria with it had a higher rate of death due to vitamin K deficiency. So there is a role for bacteria in helping us in the role of nutrition. Obviously, they get something out of it as well. And so this is really this sort of symbiotic relationship. That, I think, has been appreciated for a while. You'll see the references, you know, back from 1983. What's being only, I think, more realized now is the role of bacteria in the development of our immune system. So exposure to what we consider normal human bacteria can help to train the immune system and may have a role in helping to prevent autoimmune or allergic disease. So, you know, your immune system is designed to fight off foreign bacteria, but it has to find out the differences between bacteria and us. It essentially has to be trained so that it attacks these microorganisms, but doesn't attack our own cells. And it may be that if we aren't exposed to enough of these bacteria, our immune systems are not properly trained. This actually has a name, the hygiene hypothesis. This is an editorial in the New England Journal encouraging everyone to eat dirt. And one of the lines of evidence for this is that as the incidence of infectious diseases has plummeted, this is only just the last half of the latter century, but you know, if you're looking back farther in time, it would go down even farther, there has been an increase in autoimmune-related diseases. And this is probably multifactorial. There are probably many reasons for this, but it's thought that one contributing factor may be this fact that we are no longer exposed to microorganisms as an early in age at the same rate as we were living in sort of at least the historical past. So there may be a relationship there. Bacteria actually play a role in protecting us from bad bacteria. So over here on the end is sort of an example of a schematic of what your gut might look like. So this might be the interior of your gut. And you can see that there's a large diversity of organisms. So there are a lot of different bacteria. And they're all competing for nutrients and space and, you know, the best place to hang out on your colon. And by doing that, they really tend to suppress any one organism from becoming predominant. And what can happen when we give people antibiotics is that a side effect of that can be if you deplete the population, then if you have organisms that are resistant to that antibiotic, now you may remove the competition that they're faced with. And now all of a sudden, the bacteria in your gut, instead of having this healthy competition among many different organisms, becomes predominantly a single group of organisms. And if that single group of organisms is a pathogen, then you may have actually increased your risk for disease. And so what we tend to see is that when we treat people with antibiotics, you can see an increase in drug-resistant bacteria, which sometimes are harmful and sometimes just are happen to be drug-resistant. And it actually takes a fair amount of time until that normal equilibrium is restored and you get down to your healthy balance. So if this is such a wonderful, wonderful relationship that we have with bacteria and we walk down the beach holding hands with them, then you know, what goes wrong, right? Because obviously antibiotics have had a huge role in the public health successes of the last century, and so there must be a role for them. A way to think about what goes wrong is a disturbance of this equilibrium. And we'll talk about three ways in which this equilibrium is disturbed, leading to disease. One is the breakdown of barriers. So we saw that very early slide with the different bacterial communities living on different areas in and on your skin, in your GI tract, in your upper respiratory tract. But they're evolved to live in their part. Okay, and where you can see problems is when bacteria get to where they don't belong. Okay, although we tolerate bacteria living on our skin and our gut, et cetera, our bodies don't tolerate them living in a lot of our tissues. They don't tolerate them living in our bloodstream. They don't tolerate them very well living in your lower respiratory tract, in your lungs. And so one of the things that goes wrong is when bacteria essentially get where they don't belong. And this can be something that's pretty straightforward and within our experience, right? So you get a cut, and then these skin bacteria that normally are sort of well-controlled living out here can't get past the normal barriers of your intact skin, all of a sudden have an avenue to get into that tissue compartment, okay? So that's an example of different things like injuries, okay, that can cause that. We do this medically, right? So this is an example of an ICU patient. So if you had enough time, you could try and count all the different tubes that are going into this patient. But these are avenues that allow bacteria to get from places where they don't belong to where they don't belong, right? So here you have a nice avenue for bacteria to get down into the respiratory tract. This patient has an intravenous catheter. Bacteria can make their way into the bloodstream there. And so a key issue in this upset of equilibrium is bacteria getting to places they don't belong. And this is basically just, you know, the bacteria that live on and in us. And most of our infections are actually caused by sort of the normal bacteria that tend to hang out on our bodies. But you can get bacteria that are bad. Not all bacteria, not all bugs are friendly. And we would consider this to be an acquisition of virulence or characteristics that tend to cause damage to us. And this can happen in a couple of ways. You can acquire organisms that essentially, from the point of view of humans, are pure pathogens. They really, all they do to our bodies is cause disease. There's no equilibrium. These are patients with, this is a patient with Ebola, which is a highly virulent virus that has no real normal role. You can, how do these pure pathogens come to be? Well, one thing that can happen, and when we talk about bacteria getting where they don't belong, is that when organisms get into a species that they sort of don't belong in, then they can cause disease, the same way that when we think about bacteria crossing that barrier of your skin, they can cause disease. And so Ebola may be an example of a virus from another animal that when it makes its way into humans causes disease, and in that sense is really a pure pathogen. The other thing that can happen is that you can have strains of what we consider to be normal bacteria that acquire certain characteristics that make them dangerous. So this is an infection of the leg. This is called necrotizing fasciitis. This happens when a sort of normally relatively benign bacterium that lives in our respiratory tract acquires certain toxins and other characteristics that cause damage. Okay. So one way things can go wrong is if organisms become more virulent than we are used to them being. And then finally, the failure of our host defenses. So we talked about that, we've sort of evolved for this balance between bacteria and humans. And that suggests that there it's a give and take. And some of the give and some of the take is given by our immune system. So our immune system is meant to keep these bacteria where they belong. But if people have acquired or induced defects or deficiencies in their immune system, then we can see disease. Certainly ones we're familiar with, HIV and AIDS, less common ones such as certain inherited immune deficiencies. Many of the facets of modern medicine, so organ transplantation, chemotherapy for cancer, corticosteroids, all of these can suppress the immune system to the point that we upset that equilibrium. And then finally, even things we don't typically think of as being very damaging to the immune system can affect your immune system to the point that it can impair that defense function. So diabetes is a relatively immunocompromising condition. Pregnancy is certainly a relatively immunocompromising condition, and even stress. Illustrated here are, this is, anybody know what this is? Thrush, yeah, okay. So this is thrush. This is a fungal infection of your mouth. So this is your, if you haven't figured out, this is your oropharynx. There's a tongue depressor. And these bacteria, these fungi tend to live in your mouth but are normally well controlled. But under characteristics, under conditions of immunodeficiency, can cause infection. This is an infection known as invasive mucormycosis. This is essentially a mold that's common in the environment. It might be growing on your bread. Most of us, our immune system controls it very well, not an issue. In immunocompromised patients, including even some diabetic patients, it can cause an invasive disease. And so here you see significant tissue destruction. Okay. So faced with these challenges, these ways that, that this balance can be upset, how do we deal with this? Well, one way is we bring antibiotics into play. So we're going to talk a little bit about some of the different characteristics of antibiotics. So we'll talk about where antibiotics came from, what do they do, how is it that bacteria resists the effects of antibiotics, what are some of the consequences, both good and bad consequences of antibiotic use, how they differ from each other, and then from a sort of a higher perspective, how do we actually use antibiotics? One brief note on terminology is that I've been using the term antibiotics, but many of you may hear different terminology. The sort of the technical usage to encompass drugs that basically kill microorganisms is antimicrobials or anti-infectives. And this essentially is composed of antibacterial drugs, antiviral drugs, antifungals, antiparasitics. And you actually technically, the term antibiotic refers to just a group within antibacterials. But a common usage, which we'll use for the rest of the presentation, is antibiotics. This is just meant for things like, you know, when you hear people say, well, don't use antibiotics for the flu. Right? Antibiotics don't work against the flu. You say, well, I saw a commercial on TV that said I should take this drug for the flu. That's an antiviral drug. Okay? And again, most people tend to use the catch-all term antibiotics. So where did antibiotics come from? So this is one illustration of the introduction of various antibiotics over the last century and more. And you know, you Google where did antibiotics come from, you know, antibiotic history, this is the kind of thing you'll see. This is a terrifically human-centric and way too short of a timeline. The timeline really looks like this. So antibiotics have been around for millions and millions and millions of years. Okay? So antibiotics have been used by the bacteria, by the microorganisms against each other for a long, long time. This is just an example of a plate of different types of bacteria and fungi. So the white is basically a lawn of bacteria. And here you can see these different organisms, and you can see these clearings around the organisms. And this basically comes from this group of organisms producing an antibiotic that is killing off the white ones, leaving there a big space. So we did not invent antibiotics in any way. We discovered them, we've modified them, we used them in much higher dosages than the organisms use against each other, but they've been around for a long time. And part of the implication of that is that these organisms have been exposed to this for so long that it's not a new invention to them, and we should not be so surprised when they become resistant to antibiotics, because this has been part of their evolution for a long time. This is a cave in New Mexico, Letjia Cave. First, just take a moment, and there's a person. So be inspired by the scale of this. Here's a little guy. These are amazing rock formations. Anyway, so what does it have to do with the talk? So this cave was essentially cut off from any human intervention for millions of years, supposedly. But some researchers went into the cave and they sampled the things that were growing in the cave, and they found lots and lots of antibiotics. Okay? The organisms have been using the antibiotics on each other, even in this, you know, there's no contamination from the human world here. This just illustrates that, you know, bacteria and other organisms, they've adapted antibiotics, they invented them, they use them for their own purposes. And we've adapted them to use them for our purposes, but we certainly did not invent them. So what do antibiotics do? I'm again going to take a little bit of a human perspective here. The truth is that actually we don't really fully understand what antibiotics do. I showed you this slide that shows bacteria essentially using antibiotics to kill other organisms. But we know that actually in the environment, antibiotics tend to be present in concentrations below those that tend to kill organisms. And so they may actually have other uses. They may be used to signal between different organisms. They may be basically just metabolic byproducts. We actually don't really know. When we discovered antibiotics, their potential to kill bacteria was so great that essentially we just started developing for that purpose instead of really thinking about how they're used. But from the perspective of how we use them medically, what do antibiotics do? Well, the key component of understanding antibiotics is that they are selectively toxic. So they are toxic to bacteria, but not to us, hopefully. And this can be accomplished in a couple ways. One way is to design or adapt the antibiotics to bind to targets, so small molecules, and enzymes and proteins that aren't present in humans. So bacterial cells and human cells are similar, but there are some ways in which they're importantly different. One way that they're importantly, if that's a word, different, is that bacteria have a cell wall around their cell, and humans don't. And so many of our most successful antibiotics target that cell wall. So many of these drugs you may have heard of. So obviously the penicillin, such as penicillin, amoxicillin, cephalosporin drugs, carbapenem, which are more commonly used in the hospital. Those first three groups are of a class called beta-lactams that you may hear about. And then finally, glycopeptides. Some of you may have heard about a drug called vancomycin. So these drugs have a relatively high, what we call a therapeutic window, partly because they bind to things that humans don't really have. So that's a pretty good way to have selective toxicity. But that's not, unfortunately, we need, those antibiotics themselves aren't adequate to serve all of our purposes. And so other antibiotics have been discovered and developed. And really the key here is that these are bind to bacterial targets that for which there is an analog in humans, but they bind more strongly to the bacterial version than the human version. Some of these target ribosomes, or our protein synthesis machines. And again, these are include some that many of you have heard of, tetracyclines, drugs like erythromycin and azithromycin, other drugs like clindamycin, linazolid, the aminoglycosides. And then there are a couple of other classes that you may see where, again, they bind more strongly to the bacterial version than the human version. So fluoroquinolones, some of you heard of cipro or ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin, and then drugs that inhibit folate biosynthesis. Another way to think about what antibiotics do is how do they affect the bacteria and bacterial growth. So here's a chart of essentially the number of bacteria per millimeter. So and what you do is you start off with a certain number of bacteria, and then if these are incubated in the presence of enough food with no antibiotics around, then the bacteria will grow very quickly and multiply over a very short period of time. Administering antibiotic can do one of two things. It can either simply arrest the growth of those organisms at a certain point, whenever the drug reaches a particular concentration, or it can kill the organisms. So we call that effect bactericidal activity, and we call the effect of growth, just arresting the growth, a bacteriostatic effect. So it would seem as if it would be better to kill the bacteria, but it turns out that in most circumstances, there's actually not a substantial difference between the outcomes if you give somebody a bacteriostatic drug or a bactericidal drug. And one way to think about this is that idea of an equilibrium, is that your immune system is sort of keeping the bacteria in check. Something happens to alter that equilibrium, and the bacteria get ahead. And really, all you need to do is provide your body and your immune system a chance to catch up. And so even if you can just arrest the growth of the bacteria so that they don't continue to multiply, then ultimately your immune system will catch up and your body will do the final eradication. So it's not always the case that we need to kill all of the bacteria that are there. There are some circumstances in which it might be better to kill the bacteria. What might be one of them? Okay, so there are certain organisms that are more virulent that you may not have this time window. What else? Yeah?
Some bacteria emit toxins.
Okay, so that's interesting. So you mentioned, so some bacteria produce toxins. And a very interesting phenomenon is that in some of those cases where an organism that produces toxin is causing a disease, there have actually been some studies that actually show a benefit of some bacteriostatic drugs over cidal drugs. And the way this works is that if the bacteriostatic drugs are inhibiting the production of these toxins, then they essentially arrest the further production of the toxins, whereas the bactericidal drugs actually kill the bacteria, split them open, spill all the toxins to the environment, your environment, and kill you. So it depends. Actually, there are some cases where it might be better, some cases might be worse. Okay, so again, the virulence of the organism. Remember, we talked about this competition between your immune system and bacteria. So what might be a group of patients in which bactericidal drugs might be preferential? Right, immunocompromised patients. So that's a key population in which we tend to prefer drugs that actually kill the bacteria, because if you don't have a functioning immune system for the moment, you've had a transplant, you've had chemotherapy or something, then just inhibiting their growth of the bacteria may not be enough. So in any case, you know, an important consideration is that for most normal, otherwise healthy people who don't have a particularly virulent drug, who aren't necessarily immunocompromised, then it actually doesn't make a huge difference whether you actually kill the bacteria or just inhibit their further growth. So antibiotics obviously do these wonderful things. So how is it that bacteria can resist their effects? And there are really three main classifications of antibiotic resistance mechanisms. And one is to alter the target. So we've talked about the idea of a target, so that there's some protein or something else, some other molecule in the bacterial cell that the antibiotics bind to. And so essentially that target just changes shape so that the bacteria, the antibiotic no longer binds to it. And an example is bacterium that you may have heard about called MRSA alters its penicillin binding proteins, which we'll actually talk about in a moment, such that drugs like penicillin just don't bind to it anymore. So it essentially just changes its target. The bacteria can actually sort of actively destroy the antibiotic. So there are enzymes that can modify the antibiotic in such a way so that the antibiotic no longer works. And one of those is our beta-lactamases. So these are enzymes that modify the beta-lactam group of drugs. And those of you, you know, who sort of follow the antibiotic resistance literature or read the newspaper, may have heard about certain organisms called Klebsiella and extremely drug-resistant Klebsiella, things that have an enzyme called KPC. May or may not have crossed your path, but those are beta-lactamases. And then sort of a less common but important mechanism is to exclude the antibiotic, basically prevent it from getting to its site of infection. And this can be done in a couple of ways. Essentially, the bacteria can just change their shape or change their outer composition so that bacteria can't, that antibiotics can't get through, or the bacteria can actually actively pump the antibiotics out and reduce the concentration. And Pseudomonas is well known to do this. So just to make these a little bit more concrete, we'll look at a brief sort of illustration of how penicillin, which is, you know, again, the one of the more popular classes of antibiotics, works and how some of the resistance mechanisms come about. So let's see how this goes. This is an excellent website. I suggest you check it out. So the beta-lactam type antibiotics. So this is a cross-section of a bacterium. And here is the bacterial cell wall. And we'll zoom in on it. So again, here is, this is the inside of the bacteria. This is what we consider the bacterial membrane. And our cells have a membrane too, but what our cells don't have is a cell wall that's outside of that membrane. So here's the inside of the cell, here's the membrane, and the bacterial cell wall is essentially composed of these building blocks called peptidoglycan, and there's two main components, NAG, NAM, and they're linked to each other through, let me back up a second, they're linked to each other through these amino acids. And so you can kind of think about this as the sort of mortar between the different layers of brick in a cell wall of a bacterium. So again, these two main components of the bacterial cell wall come together, and then there are these what we call cross-linkers, those little red things, that allow the different layers to connect to each other. So they actually get synthesized inside the bacterial cell wall, or excuse me, inside the bacteria, and then put outside of the bacterial cell wall. And there's the mechanism that links them this way together, and then there's the mechanism that links them this way together. And this is what penicillin's target. And this doesn't happen spontaneously, this linking of the, this cross-linking of these little parts here of amino acids. There's an enzyme that catalyzes or makes happen the linking of those together. And the name of that is called a transpeptidase. Okay. We also call it a penicillin-binding protein, but that's not what it evolved to do. It evolved to make these crosslinks, not to bind penicillin. It just happens that penicillins do bind to these. And we'll see what the effect, that effect then is. Where did my cursor go? Come back to me. Okay. So those penicillin binding proteins make those linkages. So now your bacterial cell wall is linked between the different layers, and now it has is structurally sound enough for the bacteria to continue living. So beta-lactams like penicillin, you can see a structure there, bind to those enzymes, those penicillin binding proteins, and prevent them from forming those cross-links between the wall. And so the result is a weakened bacterial cell wall. And because bacteria tend to have a high pressure inside their cells, first of all, they don't tolerate having weak bacterial cell walls very well. The other thing is that, remember, the time scale that bacteria live on is that they're basically constantly dividing, more or less. And to do that, just like a snake needs to shed its skin, they need to break down their rigid cell walls so that they can form new ones. So essentially, these antibiotics prevent the bacteria from forming rigid cell walls. So to some extent, the bacteria kill themselves because they don't really understand that this is going on. And so in the course of dividing, they just essentially explode. So we've talked about, though, that bacteria have been antibiotics have been around for a long time. And so bacteria have developed mechanisms to resist them. So here you would see a particular gene in the DNA of a bacterium that produces a new type of protein, a new type of penicillin binding protein. And the difference is sort of illustrated just here with this bump that no longer binds penicillin as well, but can still do the job of cross-linking the cell wall. So this is an example we called an altered target. So that target of the penicillin binding protein has changed such that it can still do its job, but the bacteria can't bind to it. This is an illustration of that second mechanism of resistance, where we talked about the bacteria destroying the antibiotic. Here you would see, here's a gene for that resistance mechanism. And what happens here is that the bacteria that have this resistance mechanism spin around and then produce these enzymes called beta-lactamases, okay? And the beta-lactamases, the ACE part means it acts on beta-lactams. So they go in and basically destroy or hydrolyze that structure such that these new hydrolyzed versions of penicillin can no longer do the job. So does that sort of make sense? This is just one class, but hopefully it gives you some illustration of the different ways that the antibiotics interact with bacteria and the different ways that bacteria sort of fight back against that resistance. So let's talk a little bit about some of the consequences of antibiotic use. And there are certainly beneficial consequences. Obviously, curing infections is something we use antibiotics for. I won't bother to talk about all of the statistics, but you know, obviously one of the major advances in medicine has been the introduction, the adaptation of antibiotics for our own use. But we also use them for other important roles, including preventing infections. So for example, when you go into surgery, that's a time where someone's gonna cut you with a scalpel, and there's a good chance that bacteria that are gonna get from where they normally live into those places we said we don't want them to go. And so we often give antibiotics to prevent infections. And that's very successful. And you know, surgery wouldn't be what it is now if we didn't have antibiotics. And finally, actually, reduction in the transmission of infection. So we talked a lot about how a lot of the infections originate in sort of the bacteria that live on and in you. But some bacteria are transmissible. So a good example is the bacterium that causes tuberculosis, right? So a patient is infected with tuberculosis, can then go on to infect other people with that organism. By adequately treating the patient with tuberculosis, you've interrupted that chain of infection. Okay. So obviously, there are huge benefits to antibiotics. But there are some deleterious consequences of their use. One is a direct toxicity. So we talked about that antibiotics are developed to have selective toxicity, to be toxic to the bacteria but not to us, but it's never perfect. So we know that antibiotics certainly have side effects. They're generally perceived to be pretty well tolerated, but if you use them enough on a global scale, you'll certainly see that direct toxicity. Another consequence is something called a superinfection. And I think that was pretty well illustrated when we saw that idea of the diversity of the bacteria that are, say, in your gastrointestinal tract. When you give antibiotics, you allow one group of bacteria to sort of predominate. And if that predominant group of bacteria goes on and itself causes infection, we think of that as a superinfection, basically an infection on top of an infection. An infection that essentially was enabled by the fact you gave antibiotics and killed off certain groups of bacteria. And then finally, what we're going to talk a little bit more about is selection for antibiotic-resistant organisms. So how does that work in very sort of simple terms? So in a population of bacteria, so each of the little ones here is a different bacterium, let's say, you will have some pre-existing organisms that have some sort of mutation that renders them resistant to antibiotics. This is one scheme. There are different ways, but this is a useful way to think about. So these organisms might possess one of those resistance mechanisms. Now, those resistance mechanisms sometimes come with what we would consider to be a cost, right? The bacteria have to produce a different protein than they normally would. And when they're all competing against each other, that may mean that those organisms don't do as well. But in the presence of antibiotics, all of a sudden, the other bacteria killed off, and those organisms that were in the minority that produce that protein or that resistance mechanism now are what's left, and they now predominate. And now your entire population of bacteria consists of the progeny of those resistant organisms. One question that people might have is, well, why didn't this always happen? Why doesn't it always happen that we select for resistant bacteria? And part of it is that when you get to this stage and there's only a few bacteria left, your immune system can clean these up, right? All of a sudden, your immune system catches up and says, well, you're maybe resistant to antibiotics, but you're not resistant to your immune system. Okay, so that's one way in which we keep resistance down. And an important consideration is that even when we take antibiotics away, we are still left with some of these resistant organisms. We've basically enriched the entire population in the number of resistant isolates of that organism. So we observe this not only at a molecular level, but at what we would consider to be an ecologic or a larger scale. So this is a graph of use. So let me just explain the axes here. This is basically total usage of beta-lactam type, like penicillin type antibiotics in these countries, right? So this is the United Kingdom, Spain, et cetera. So these are countries of the European Union. So as you go across here, you see an increased total amount of that country's use of antibiotics. And the axis here is a representation, it's log scale, et cetera, but basically the prevalence of drug-resistant bacteria resistant to penicillins. And so we see this effect of antibiotic resistance when we look at, when we compare geography, right? So areas that have higher use of antibiotics tend to have more antibiotic resistance. We can also see this develop over time. So this is just at a single hospital looking at the relationship between the light line here is the total amount of the sum of the use of certain classes of antibiotics. So again, as this fluctuates, the use of antibiotics is plotted here. And then the prevalence or the amount of drug-resistant bacteria here, methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, is tracked in the black line. And so you can see as antibiotic use goes up, antibiotic resistance tends to follow. such that, you know, you get to the situation that we tend to be at. So this is national data from the United States over time, resistance to we talked about that organism MRSA, Pseudomonas, a complicated organism usually seen in hospitals, and drug-resistant Acinetobacter. And you can see over time the prevalence of these has increased, but actually you've seen a little bit of a sort of leveling off effect of these organisms, which we've considered to be a real danger to our hospitals. And in fact, what we're starting to see is bacteria that we had not anticipated being a real problem for us becoming very drug resistant. And what's even more concerning about these bacteria is that, unlike some of the other ones that I talked about in the previous slide, these organisms are very common in the community. So the two organisms plotted here are E. coli. So E. coli is by far the most common cause of urinary tract infections. A lot of other infections, including gastrointestinal tract infections. Klebsiella tends to be right behind E. coli in terms of causing things like urinary tract infections. And over the last 10, 11 years or so, while the percentage numbers of resistance, these are multi-drug resistance, is still relatively low, the growth rate in resistance has been very, very alarming among these organisms. And again, these are multi-drug resistant organisms for which we maybe have one or two antibiotics that are useful. So let's take a second to sort of stop and review where we've gotten with the basic science-oriented type of things, because we're going to start to talk a little bit more about how we use antibiotics. So we know that, you know, we're certainly colonized with a term that we often use is commensal, meaning bacteria that just sort of live on us and hang out with these commensal bacteria and flora, and that our WBC is our white cells, that they sort of have this relationship and there's an equilibrium. Something comes in and disturbs that equilibrium, some disruption of the homeostasis, or a virulent organism comes and jumps on board, and we develop an infection. Within that population of bacteria, it's possible that just through random mutation, there is a small subpopulation of resistant organisms. And when we use bacteria, when we use antibiotics, if we do it in the right way, if we give the right antibiotic, we use it the right dose, treat for the right duration, and especially if our immune system is there to help out, we can basically eradicate the infection and then ultimately over time get back into homeostasis. Where there's a problem is if we don't use antibiotics correctly, if we give them inadequately, an inadequate dose or duration, or if our immune system isn't helping out, then you develop a resistant subpopulation of bacteria. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how antibiotics differ in a not mechanism or not very basic way. And one of the key ways, and for practicing clinicians, probably the most important way that antibiotics actually differ from each other is something we call the spectrum of activity, which is the number and diversity of bacteria that an antibiotic is considered to have useful activity against. And we think about spectrum activity as being sort of narrow spectrum, right? So you might say in this whole group of bacteria on this plate, a narrow spectrum antibiotic might just kill this one, okay? On the other end, we have broad spectrum bacteria, which is sort of like the nuclear bomb against bacteria and just kind of wipes them all out indiscriminately. So our antibiotics tend to lie on this spectrum of narrow to broad spectrum. And that spectrum can be actually pretty substantial. This is, so a bunch of pharmacists and physicians got together and kind of thought about what makes something a broad spectrum antibiotic, and they kind of came up with this relative scale. But the numbers by themselves don't really mean anything, but you can see from one end of the spectrum, a very narrow spectrum antibiotic, to the other end of the spectrum, very broad spectrum antibiotics, again, on this somewhat arbitrary scale, varies about 20 or 30 fold. So antibiotics differ substantially in essentially the effect or their spectrum, how many different types of bacteria that they kill. And there are situations in which we want to use narrow spectrum antibiotics, and there's situations in which we want to use broad spectrum antibiotics. So let's think a little bit about how do we actually use antibiotics clinically? So, you know, if you had an infection and went in to see your doctor, how would your doctor think about using antibiotics? So an infection is suspected, and you know, really one of the things that the doctor thinks about is, do I need to treat this right away? So would a delay in therapy be harmful to the patient? Okay. If the answer is no, then we can try and gather more information. And this might be done by obtaining a culture to try and identify what organism is causing that infection in you. And when that's done and known, and typically this takes 48 to 72 hours, and Dr. Chu, I know, talked about some of the limitations of our current diagnostics, and we'll talk about those a little bit too. But assuming that you actually figure this out, you can select what we call the definitive antibiotic against the known organism that's causing your infection. Okay, that's great. And in that circumstance, you might be able to choose a very narrow spectrum antibiotic because you know exactly what it is you're treating. And then you can complete your treatment course. But if a delay in therapy would be harmful to you, you don't want, you know, your doctor to take some culture and say, well, you know, come back in 2 or 3 days and you're dead, right? Not useful, okay? So if a delay in therapy would be harmful to the patient, then we say we have to select an empiric antibiotic regimen, meaning essentially our best guess of an antibiotic that's going to, what the term that's commonly used is cover, the likely pathogens. So, you know, we know that if you have this type of infection, if you have a urinary tract infection, the most likely organisms are these. So we're going to pick this antibiotic that probably covers those. Okay. Another consideration that's then made is that, are the benefits of obtaining a culture so that you know exactly what's causing the infection perceived to outweigh the risk? Many of you, you've probably been to doctors to get antibiotics before, and you say, well, I didn't get a culture. And that's because it may be that the risks of getting a culture may not be perceived to outweigh the benefits. If they are, if that is thought, though, well, there's benefits to getting a culture, then antibiotics are started, but a culture is started, is obtained as well, and then you go down this path. But if not, then basically you complete the entire treatment course with the physician's best guess, okay, with the best guess of what the right antibiotic is for you. And actually, what's interesting is that these are numbers I sort of made up, but this is actually the most common path. Most commonly, a physician is going to prescribe you an antibiotic and actually not get that information to guide the specific therapy in you. You're never going to know what your actual organism is, okay? Especially in an outpatient setting. In the inpatient setting, we more commonly get cultures. I mean, you could say part of the reason, well, why don't we get cultures more? And again, Dr. Chu, I'm sure, talked about this a little bit with you, but just to review, our current tests are slow. It takes several days to get an answer. They may be insensitive in that the culture result might come back negative, but maybe you really do have an infection. They can also be nonspecific. So sometimes organisms that aren't actually causing your infection are detected. So for example, if you had we thought to have a sinus infection, say, well, you know, my sinuses are like here, so I'm gonna take a Q-tip, I'm gonna shove it up my nose and just wiggle it around and pull it out, and whatever grows is going to be what causes the infection. And what'll happen is that a whole bunch of stuff will grow, because bacteria normally live in your sinuses, okay? And instead, if you really wanted to know what organism was causing your sinus infection, you would take a needle and you would stick it through your cheek into that air sinus, okay? And that would allow you to bypass all those bacteria that normally live there and get right to the site of infection. Most people, not surprisingly, are unwilling to sign up for this, right? And so a major limitation of our current techniques for obtaining that information is that they tend to be invasive, right? Because most of our infections happen somewhere in our tissues, places we don't like people sticking needles. And a balancing is that antibiotic use is sort of perceived to be relatively low risk, right? If you had symptoms that were suggestive of cancer, your doctor would not empirically treat you for cancer, right? They're not saying, well, you know what, you might have cancer, so why don't you go take some chemotherapy and then we'll kind of see, right? Obviously, you know, chemotherapy drugs are viewed as way too toxic for that. But to some extent, antibiotics are perceived to be a lower risk, and so there's a different threshold for using them in that way. This is just an example of the fact that even for serious infections, a fair amount of time, we don't actually ever know what the exact organism causing the infection is. So antibiotic use is generally based on your physician's estimation of, first of all, your risk of having an infection. There are conditions that may look like infection, but aren't actually infections. And so that's the first thing that your physician has to try and make a good guess at. The risk of various bacteria being the cause of an infection. So we said that, well, we know that certain bacteria tend to cause certain types of infection, but that might be a group of 20 different bacteria that typically cause infection X. And so your physician has to sort of weigh the risk of those different bacteria being the cause. We have to think about the risk of different antibiotics working against those bacteria. So now you have to match up the different bacteria that are likely the cause and all the different antibiotics we have that differ in how they cover those bacteria. So now you're coming across a fairly complex calculation. And the other thing that your physician has to consider is, what if I'm wrong? What's the risk of bad consequences if the antibiotics don't work against those bacteria? And in some circumstances, the risk is relatively low, right? And it's well, you know, you may have an upper respiratory tract infection, and if I pick the wrong antibiotic, you might not be so happy. Your symptoms would go on for a little while longer, but you wouldn't die. But if you're a patient in a hospital with sepsis, picking the wrong antibiotic might mean that you don't survive that episode. So they also have to think about the consequences. Balanced against the risk of bad effects to you personally, okay, the things we talked about, direct toxicity, superinfections, et cetera, and this idea of every time we use antibiotics, even in the most minuscule way, we reduce their utility for other people. And antibiotics are really unique among all classes of drugs in that way, right? So it doesn't matter if, you know, all of us here are on cholesterol-lowering drugs, it's not going to reduce the effectiveness of cholesterol-lowering drugs in other people. It may bankrupt the state and, you know, they may not be able to get it for that reason, but it doesn't directly affect their utility. So that's another consideration that physicians have. How do physicians actually weigh these things? So this was a case where physicians were asked to think about what are the different factors that influence their selection of an antibiotic in a hypothetical patient with a hypothetical infection. And what they found was that really the most important considerations were, how likely is this drug going to be to work in this patient? And I think that's reasonable. Obviously, you know, there's a relationship that you have with your physician where they feel like, you know, they really need to do what's best for you. But actually the bottom here, the least important factor, was the risk of contributing to this problem of antibiotic resistance. And this doesn't mean that physicians don't think this is important. It's just that your treating physician really is thinking about their relationship with you and treating your infection. But we also have to think about what the use of antibiotic means for the utility of these drugs for people in general. And what makes this complicated is this idea of risk, okay? Because different people can perceive that risk of contributing to the problem of resistance differently. And what that affects your judgment is, well, am I going to choose a broad spectrum antibiotic that might contribute more to the risk? Or am I going to pick a narrow spectrum antibiotic that might contribute less? Well, if you pick the broad spectrum antibiotic, you're less likely to be wrong in your individual patient. Okay? Whereas you pick the narrow spectrum one, you might miss that one in your patient. And, you know, again, people have different ways that they think about these. Here's just one illustration.
If you are not good, like 1 out of 100, I'd say more like 1 out of 1,000,000. So you're telling me there's a chance.
And we experience this type of phenomenon in the hospital where, you know, you have people taking care of patients and they're selecting an antibiotic and think, well, you know, I might need to select this really, really broad spectrum antibiotic because there's a eensy-weensy chance that the patient might have a particular bacteria. And, you know, the problem with that is that essentially the broader spectrum antibiotics you pick, the more you're contributing to the overall problem. But it's a very difficult calculation. And again, a challenge is that this is not a decision that's black and white, and so there are different things that influence this. here are the countries of more or less the European Union, and the different shades of colors are essentially the density of different of antibiotic use in the different countries. So the darker the colors, so red and these other colors indicate more use, and the greener colors indicate sort of less use. Again, this is at a countrywide level. You might say, well, you know, what explains the variation? You know, I mean, they're Europe, they're pretty similar in their, you know, healthcare systems, et cetera, but you could probably think about certain reasons. And it turns out that there are surveys that to sort of look at national, essentially personality characteristics. What are some characteristics of that people in that country? And an interesting study here correlated essentially how likely you are to receive an antibiotic for cold, flu, sore throat, things we tend to discourage antibiotic use for, and essentially a cultural dimension of uncertainty avoidance. Okay, how much does that culture, you know, value not being uncertain? And there's a pretty good relationship here, in that, you know, a lot of these higher use countries like to avoid the uncertainty. And that's what we see playing out on an individual basis, because it's a decision your physician has to make about, you know, how comfortable they are with the risk that comes with selecting a particular antibiotic. Interestingly enough, there also is a somewhat of a correlation between national cultural correlates of masculinity. And although you might think that the more masculine countries would tough it out without antibiotics, it turns out that actually it's the opposite. Interestingly, we know that similar variability exists in the United States. So this is actually relatively recent data looking at density of antibiotic use in different parts of the country. And this data is adjusted for differences in overall illnesses, et cetera. Now, we don't have a masculinity scale or anything to correlate to, but it's clear that there's really unexplained variability in antibiotic use. And so this just illustrates that there's a personal or you know, a human component to picking antibiotics that is a big influence on or over what how much antibiotic gets used, and then ultimately what the outcomes are in terms of our antibiotic resistance. So I want to, you know, use this brief illustration to talk about the trade-offs that come. So you know, here, this is something called the tragedy of the commons. Some of you may have heard about this term in sociology. And an illustration comes with a story that may or may not be true about farmers in rural England. So back then, in medieval times, each town had what was called a commons, an area where any of the farmers could graze their cattle beyond just the lands that they owned. And what they would see is that, you know, over time, the farmers would realize that they would sort of benefit the most if they let their cattle graze on the commons as much as possible, because then they don't deplete their own grass and they, you know, sort of get ahead. Their cattle come to market faster. Unfortunately, what this ends up happening is that the commons becomes completely depleted, because everybody lets their cows overgraze on them because it's not their personal land. And so this essentially coined a term of the idea of the tragedy of the commons. And I think this has some analogies to the situation that we face with antibiotic use. This is actually something that's known as a social trap, which is the exploitation of a finite common resource without a technical solution. For the problem of the cows, you could imagine a technical solution to this problem essentially just being Miracle-Gro grass, right? So the cows come in, they completely overgraze the commons, but the next day the grass grows back again, all right? It's a technical solution to the problem. Nobody has to make a sacrifice. A non-technical solution is for everybody to get together and say, okay, look, this is crazy. We all have to come up to some kind of agreement about how much of this finite common resource any one person can use. And there are some analogies with the problem that we face with antibiotic resistance. For a long time, we actually sort of had a technical solution to this problem, which was the development of new antibiotics. In that, you know, we would introduce some antibiotics, resistance would develop, but it wouldn't be a problem because a new class of antibiotics would be introduced such that the previous resistance wasn't an issue. So for a long time, we weren't really faced with the full scale of this challenge. So a technical solution is new antibiotic development. The non-technical solution, the agreement by everybody on how to, you know, best use antibiotics so that we don't deplete this resource, is a concept we talk about called antibiotic stewardship. So talk a little bit about these concepts. So again, the idea of antibiotic development. So here was the technical solution to our problem. So for several decades, every few years, a new class of antibiotics was introduced such that, well, if you develop resistance to this one, that's fine, because a few years later, we have this one. But as some of you may know, antibiotic development basically fell off the cliff. And for decades, there were no new classes of antibiotics developed. So that technical solution sort of wasted away for many decades. And you know, this is, again, more recent data. These are new antibiotics approved by the FDA. But these are not all novel classes. Some of these are essentially what we would consider to be me too antibiotics. They don't really add much to our armamentarium. And even these have been dwindling substantially over the last couple of decades. So if we want to go back to the good old days of not having to worry about sharing our antibiotic resource and just inventing new antibiotics, unfortunately, we have a long way to go. Some efforts are being made to promote new antibiotic development. So one of these is an initiative with the FDA promoting antibiotic development, the special population limited medical use pathway, with where smaller, more limited scope clinical trials are allowed to be performed for new antibiotics. And the result being that the drug would then be approved only for specific indications. Now, as it is right now, when any drug is approved for any indication, a physician is essentially free to use it for whatever indication they want. This approval would put in new mechanisms to really limit the usage of these antibiotics that are approved on data that we would not be as comfortable with the exception that we are facing such a crisis with antibiotic resistance. Another mechanism is prolonging the patent duration or increasing the incentive for pharmaceutical companies. So proposals have been such that for any new antibiotics, an extension of 5 more years to the patent life over what the standard patent lives are. If this is the first in a new class of antibiotics, 3 more years on top of that. If there are studies demonstrating utility in critical need areas, this also goes for antibiotics that have already been approved, an extension of the patent life for another year. So trying to put more incentives for drug companies to develop antibiotics. One of the reasons that those drug companies have gotten out of the business is because, you know, your typical duration of antibiotic use is a week, 2 weeks, right? People are on a cholesterol drug for their whole life. And in fact, if you can think about the one area of sort of anti-infective research that has really surged ahead in the last few decades are drugs for treatment of HIV, which are drugs that people take for their entire life. So really, we have to figure out a way, if we want to continue our current path of private investment in these drugs, of providing new incentives. So the other non-technical solution is the idea of finding a way to better share this resource. And again, this is a term that we use, antibiotic stewardship, used to describe efforts to try and make the best use of antibiotics. And this is really a responsibility of both clinicians, healthcare professionals, physicians, pharmacists, everybody, healthcare organizations, the government, and each of you. So, you know, the role of the individual physicians, there are things that we work on every day with our trainees and our doctors to try and improve their use of antibiotics, to be able to sort of more promptly identify patients who require antibiotics. And we need better and new tools for these, such as some of the things that Dr. Chu talked about. Although it tends to come with a trade-off, it can help if we obtain cultures before we start antibiotics. So we may need to think more about making that trade-off of, you know, if I get a culture, yes, it means that I might stick a needle somewhere you don't like, or it might just be one more test, blood test, for example, that you have to do. It may be that we have to think about that calculus somewhat differently. We need to think about people who are allergic to antibiotics and people who think they're allergic to antibiotics. A big reason why we don't use certain antibiotics is because people say, well, they have a penicillin allergy. But in many cases, and in fact most of those cases, those people can safely receive penicillins. We need to think about what our local environment is in terms of susceptibility, starting antibiotics at the right time, treating people for the expected duration of therapy, for a duration of therapy based on evidence and guidelines. So, you know, any of you who've been around or gotten enough courses of antibiotics know that, you know, what's a common duration of antibiotics? A week, right? 7 days, 10 days, 14 days, 21 days. Those are football scores, right? I mean, they represent thinking about the condition from a human perspective instead of a bacterial perspective. And, you know, it's certainly possible that we are in many cases treating people for way too long and exposing people to antibiotics that don't need it. And there really is not a lot of good data about how long people really needed to be treated for. But there is more emerging data on this subject. And it may be that in a couple of years, you know, a condition you got treated for 2 weeks for, you might be treated for 1 week for, because we found that there's no difference. And again, you know, picking the right dose, treating people with the right spectrum of antibiotic, and watching for toxicity. A role of our healthcare system also comes into play. And so this is, as Jen talked about, this is part of my role at the hospital, is to oversee antibiotic use within our healthcare system. And we try and monitor and intervene at different points in the healthcare process. So as clinicians are evaluating patients and choosing what antibiotic to prescribe, we really want to educate them on what are the bacteria that are most likely to cause this infection, and matching that up with the antibiotics that are most likely to cover those bacteria and are not going to cause side effects, are not going to treat bacteria you don't need to be treated. In some cases, we have some antibiotics that we think are either so valuable or, in some cases, so toxic or sometimes so expensive that we actually restrict their use. Okay, and we say that, you know, before you know, your doctor can use these drugs, you need to consult with an infectious diseases expert. And then a big part of what we do is, you know, this idea that when you get a culture, you then have more information available at a later point in time. And we want to make sure that physicians are using that information appropriately. And so one thing that we do in the hospital is that we monitor the use of certain antibiotics. And we say, okay, well, you know, you started this broad spectrum antibiotic because you didn't know what was causing the infection. Well, then you did a culture and you found out this is the organism. So let's change to a narrow spectrum antibiotic that just treats that one organism and doesn't affect all your other bacteria. So this is a role that you will now find in most hospitals. Most hospitals, at least in California, because this is something that the government has mandated, have some mechanism for ensuring appropriate antibiotic use. The government certainly has a role. The CDC has a campaign called Get Smart About Antibiotics. So part of the government's role is to educate the public, to enact regulations. As we mentioned, in California, it's actually a law that every hospital has to have some mechanism for ensuring an appropriate antibiotic use. And California is the first state in the nation to enact this, but many other states are interested. And many of the major healthcare organizations, like Medicare, an organization some of you may have heard about called JCO, or the Joint Commission, are exploring making this a quality consideration, meaning that Medicare won't certify your hospital unless there's a mechanism to make sure antibiotics are appropriately used. And I think that will lead to a lot of changes. And as we talked about, incentivizing the pharmaceutical industry. But all of us have a role. All of you in the audience, all of us, me, and all of us, when we're patients, we have a role too. We have a role in educating ourselves, and all of you, the fact that you're here, you obviously take that seriously. A key component is in your role as a patient and as your best advocate for yourself. You always want to, you know, advocate for what's best for you. But one thing that's probably not best for you is insisting on antibiotics. So many of the common conditions that you would probably present to care, at least as an outpatient for, are a lot of them are caused by viruses and not bacteria, and you would not benefit from an antibacterial drug. And you would think that, well, what difference does it make if I go in and I say, hey, doc, I think I need an antibiotic? the doctor is going to prescribe what is best for me. No, you have a huge influence on what the physician prescribes. This is one study that looked at the likelihood of a patient receiving antibiotics for a condition that is almost certainly due to a virus for which bacteria antibacterial drugs will not benefit. If the physician that perceives that antibiotics are expected, they're very likely to prescribe them. If the physician does not perceive that antibiotics are expected, they're more likely not to. And this study has been replicated numerous times, looking at individual patients, parents of children. Patients have a huge influence on physician prescribing behaviors. So, you know, obviously you want to be an advocate for yourself, but because you can influence physicians so strongly this way, try to make sure that you're not expecting antibiotics and leaving it for your physician's judgment, at least for your kind of average, everyday, minor conditions. Get vaccinated. So a huge way to reduce your risk of infection and for certain infections to reduce the overall prevalence of these drug-resistant organisms is to get vaccinated. If you get, for example, the flu vaccine, okay, you're less likely to get the flu. You say, well, the flu's not a bacteria. I don't have to worry about antibiotic resistance. But if you get the flu, your chances of getting a bacterial infection are increased, and then your chances of getting a resistant bacterial infection are increased. So getting vaccinated helps the antibiotic resistance problem as well. Wash your hands. Okay. I don't think there's much more needs to say about that. Don't take antibiotics prescribed for others. Okay, I know that, you know, in many cases there's leftover antibiotics that, you know, your spouse has, your friend has, whatever. You say, well, you know, last time I got this, so it was the same antibiotic, so maybe I should take it. And as we've seen, it's not just that, you know, we try and discourage this practice just because we want to be controlling. There's a very good chance that it would be the wrong antibiotic. So we talked about that spectrum of activity and how it varies 30 or 40 fold. So, you know, you using another antibiotic may not be the right one for your condition. And here's a little secret that even med students don't learn until a few years in. Mycin, that doesn't mean anything, okay? So you know, you'll hear about a whole bunch of antibiotics called mycins. And you'll say, well, I can take this one because last time I had a mycin. I'm just going to take another one. This one, since it's a mycin, must be the same. Actually, the suffix mycin has to do with what organism they were derived from. It has nothing to do with how they actually work, which bacteria they affect, anything else. So even that is not a safe route for you. So just don't take antibiotics prescribed for others. Take antibiotics as directed, okay? I know that sometimes, for necessity or other reasons, your physicians will give you prescriptions for antibiotics you have to take multiple times a day. Okay, there are some antibiotics that, you know, you read their package insert, says you're supposed to take it four times a day. I don't know that anybody actually takes anything four times a day. So when possible, I try and discourage that practice. But if you are getting a prescription for antibiotics that you're supposed to take multiple times a day, try your best to take it those multiple times a day, because a key risk for developing antibiotic resistance is getting subtherapeutic levels. So taking an antibiotic that you're supposed to take twice a day, if you only take it once a day, then there's going to be a prolonged period of time where the concentration of the antibiotic is low, and that's just enough to tease the bacteria into resistance. We talked about for the prescribed duration. What I would say right now is to take it for the duration that your physician tells you, even though you don't exactly know how long that should be, okay? And just know that over time, the durations that are recommended may change. But for now, it's best to take it for the prescribed duration. Okay, I have a couple more minutes, and so I want to kind of take a different approach and talk a little bit about maybe sort of bring it back full circle to our relationship with bacteria and maybe provide some new avenues for ways forward through this antibiotic resistance crisis. So some new frontiers in bacterial human relations. Instead of fighting bugs with the metabolic byproducts of bugs, which is basically what we do right now, right? We take these metabolic byproducts of bacteria, put them in very high concentrations, and then kill other bugs with them. Well, what about fighting bugs instead with just other smaller bugs? Or with friendly bugs? So let's talk about that. So the same way that we have bacteria on and in us, bacteria can actually have other smaller microorganisms that are on and in them. And one group of those is known as bacteriophages. And these are viruses. So I know the text is probably too hard to read here, but what you can see is that these are have these very interesting shapes. And when you learn about these in school, you say, there's no way they actually look like that, right? Like, that's a wonderful little representation. And, you know, if somebody was drawing an evil organism, that's what they'd draw. But they actually look like this. It's really exciting, actually. But anyway, so these viruses attach themselves to bacteria, do what viruses do, which is squirt in their DNA. The bacteria then make copies of that DNA and sometimes make it into RNA. Then the viruses replicate, and then the viruses do what they do. They spread, and in spreading, they tend to burst open the cells. So the same way that viruses, in a sense, parasitize our cells, they can parasitize bacteria. And what this means, and it turns out that they're very specific for which bacteria they affect. So there are all sorts of different bacteriophages and all sorts of different bacteria that they attack. And some benefits of these as therapeutics, they are self-amplifying, right? Instead of giving somebody, you know, a fixed dose of these, you can give a very small amount of this virus, and it basically, you know, creates more of itself that goes on and kills more bacteria. It's self-limiting. Right? So once those bacteria, the specific bacteria that these viruses attack, are gone, then these viruses just go away. They don't attack your own cells. They tend to be ultra narrow spectrum. So there's some, so they're not useful as broad spectrum antibiotics, but in terms of being very narrow spectrum, they're very useful because they're sort of biologically determined just to attack certain bacteria. And importantly, they have a completely different mechanism than our antibiotics, and so there's no cross-resistance. It turns out that this was studied a long, long time ago. And in fact, even before the antibiotic era, there were people using bacteriophages to treat all sorts of conditions. This is actually from the precursor to the Journal of the American Medical Association. And here's a sort of an article on bacteriophage therapy from 1934. But basically what happened is that antibiotics were discovered, and the process of making these and tailoring to the right patient, et cetera, is really kind of time consuming. And so the sort of industrial type of paradigm that you can apply towards, you know, production of these small molecule antibiotics was sort of more economically fit. And so these essentially languished for decades. And unfortunately, there's still not a lot of good data on the use of this in patients. There is starting to be some, and so there are some studies underway, but there's nothing really as much as a large-scale clinical trial. But a number of companies are interested in pursuing this as therapeutics. And again, it may have a number of advantages. And then finally, fighting bugs with about the same size, but friendly bugs. And this is the idea of probiotics. And so we talked about that there are bacteria in and on you that sort of just do their thing and don't necessarily cause any adverse effects. And so there, people are very interested in, can we give beneficial bacteria? Especially in the context of, if you receive antibiotics or if you have another condition that wipes out that normal bacteria that are in there, is there a way that we can repopulate your colon, really, with good bacteria instead of bad bacteria? And interestingly, there are a lot of studies on the subject. This is a Journal of the American Medical Association, what we call a meta-analysis, that looks at all of these individual studies of probiotics and looks at their effects. And each study tends to be all over the place. But in this case, the overall summative effect of them is that they appear to be beneficial in this outcome, which is preventing diarrhea associated with antibiotic use. The main limitation is that the organisms that are used differ, and the particular preparations tend to vary a lot more than an individual drug does. Okay, but this is an exciting avenue that people are interested in. And then finally, when probiotics aren't enough, right? Probiotics tend to be a mixture of just a few bacteria, and we try and pick bacteria that we think are beneficial. But it really doesn't replicate the full diversity of what's in your colon. And so why not just take what's in a healthy person's colon and put it into a diseased person's colon? And so this is what's being studied. duodenal infusion of donor feces, donor feces, for recurrent Clostridium difficile. This is an intestinal infection that can be very difficult to treat. So some of you are chewing this over in your head, and yes, it is basically just what you think it is. You have a donor, you have a blender, and then thankfully you have a tube going down the person's nose directly into their esophagus, down their esophagus into their colon. Nobody has to actually swallow anything. So it seems like this is very, very extreme and maybe just ridiculous. But it turns out that this is a hugely effective intervention for, at least for certain patients that have a very, very treatment-resistant infection. And this looks at, again, from the study, compared to the gold standard antibiotic for this condition of Clostridium difficile, the treatment with infusion of these donor feces, much, much more effective, cured without relapse here. And what you can see is this is an index of how diverse the bacteria, a group of bacteria are. This is the diversity of different antibiotics in your colon. And this is the diversity in the patients who are afflicted. And you can see that there's not much diversity in those bacteria, right? That we talked about, you know, getting antibiotics kills off and reduces that diversity. And essentially, after infusion, you've restored that diversity. So just to wrap up, and then we'll take some questions. So bacteria are everywhere on us and in us. But that's how it was meant to be. So for the most part, it's OK, except when things go wrong, in which case antibiotics can be beneficial and even life-saving. But we don't always know which ones to use because of some of the limitations of our current diagnostics. And so there's a tendency to use what we consider to be the big guns or broader spectrum antibiotics because you don't want to put your patient at risk if you can avoid it. Unfortunately, you know, using broader spectrum antibiotics tends to promote more rapid development of antibiotic resistance. We used to invent our way out of this problem by developing new antibiotics, but that well has at least temporarily really run dry. And so now we sort of have to conserve our way out of it by making better use of the antibiotics we have. And maybe even changing the way we think about how we coexist with the bacterial world. So at this point, I'll take any questions, and I hope we can have some discussion. Thanks.